Thanks for stopping by AutoTechNick. In today's video, we're going to go into detail on pump clearances and really what you need to know when you're replacing internal components inside either a Berkeley or Dominator pump. All right, before we really dive in on this pump and what my issues are and what I'm going to do to correct them, I'm going to give you a little bit of a real quick backstory. It's going to help explain the situation for you as well. So on my jet boat here that you can see that's going through a restoration, it originally came with that Dominator pump installed. Now, we also got that Berkeley pump with the jet boat as a spare from the previous owner. Now, we were told that this boat, the previous owners back in the 80s, they tried to drag race this boat and they decided not to because it was just too big and heavy, which they were on the right track with that one. Now, this Berkeley pump, like I mentioned, came to us as a spare at the boat. It was freshly rebuilt when we got it, and we knew that it had a stainless steel A-cut impeller on it. Forever, we just had this pump sitting on a shelf and never really paid much attention to it, and we always ran the boat with this Dominator pump below. Now, this Dominator pump had an aluminum A impeller, which was fine because for the longest time, we ran this jet boat running a mild 396. Well, now the jet boat is going to be running a pretty well-built 496. That's making about 630 horsepower. So we wanted to switch this pump because of the stainless impeller. We didn't want to swap the impeller because the Dominator pump has the provisions for the back lip on the back of the impeller. This impeller doesn't have it, and also this pump was set up for this impeller. Now, by setup is what I mean is it was set up as a tight or a race pump where they went ahead and machined everything in here to close up the tolerances. Well, if you look at my very early videos that I first started doing on YouTube, I pulled this pump apart, I repainted it. While I had it apart, I decided to stuff an inducer on it. I sent my shaft out to have it remachined for the inducer, and as what they did is they actually swapped my shaft and kept my old one that the pump was rebuilt with and sent me a new one already cut for an inducer. Doesn't seem like a big deal, but let me grab the camera and show you what happened. Okay, so I got a light up under here in the suction housing so you can see into the pump, and if you look carefully, you can see right here where the suction housing ends. I have what looks to be a quarter inch gap before you get to my impeller. Now, before I replace the shaft, I know that that clearance from the front lip of the impeller to the suction housing was approximately 30 thousandths. Now, I'm rocking about a quarter inch. I can't even get my bowl on now because that moved the impeller back so far that the back edge of the impeller is hitting the bowl and I can't get everything closed up. Since I ran into this issue and I knew machine work was going to be required to get this fixed, I just went ahead and decided to do it all at once and put a stuffer in. Before they swapped the shaft on me, I had about 30 thousandths of clearance of that impeller in front of the pump and about 30 thousandths from the back flange of the bowl to the back face of the impeller. These stuffers are pretty thick. I think this one's over 100 thousandths thick, so there's no way I can fit that in there without machining down my bowl to get that cut down. Because I have to go in and address this to get the impeller moved forward, that's why I chose to do that now. Otherwise, I just would have left it. By adding in the stuffer, it's going to help take up all that space behind the impeller and the bowl, and also the cavity where the main mass of this is to really help things out. So I need to go ahead and basically get some measurements on this, get my shaft remachined, get the impeller to fit to the suction housing, then I'm going to have to go back and see what I need to do to the bowl to get it to fit with the stuffer. All right, like I mentioned, I can't even bolt the bowl on all the way because it's interfering with the back of the impeller and basically bottoming out. Now, there's multiple ways we can go ahead and fix this issue. I think the most logical for me and the way I'm going to go is I'm gonna have the shaft machined. So I'm gonna go ahead and move the inducer and impeller forward on the shaft, which is gonna go ahead and give me the proper clearances I need to the suction housing. Now, since I'm doing this stuffer on the back end, I'm still gonna have issues. And I'm gonna probably have to have the bowl milled out where the stuffer sits into the bowl, but I'm gonna address that after the fact once the front part of the pump is taken care of. I'm essentially gonna break this down into two sections. I'm gonna get the shaft machined, get the impeller inducer set up in the suction housing, then I'm gonna go and take care of the bowl and the stuffer. before I even sent my old shaft off, before I even repainted the pump, right after it was rebuilt, I have documented and I pulled the measurements running off the back face of this impeller to the back face of where the bowl mounts onto the suction housing. That essentially is going to give me my depth of where the impeller sits into the suction housing. So I have that measurement from where it used to be. Obviously, I can pull that measurement now and see where it's at now. And theoretically, that's going to go ahead and give me how much material needs to be machined off the shaft. So I could take my measurement now, subtract the measurement from before, have that much machined off. I'm going to go one step further though. I'm going to go ahead and pull the impeller inducer. I plan on removing the shaft. I'm going to set the impeller in so it bottoms out, and that way it's going to give me my absolute bottoming zero measurement. Now with that measurement, that should coincide also with the gap that I had, my 30 thousandths gap that I had, and the height measurement I had from last time. So it's a redundancy thing. I know where my bottoming out going too far forward is, I know where it used to be, and I know where it is now. So I can use those three measurements, give that information to the machine shop. They can go ahead and just spin the shaft down on a lathe and get it to where I need it. Now, I did order a shim kit just in case. So if I'm gonna err on the side of caution, I want them to machine a little too much and move everything forward a little too far, because then I can use these shims of different thicknesses and bring it back where I want it without any extra machine work. Now the next steps is I need to go ahead and I will just retake the measurements with the pump the way it is now. We need to pull it apart and get the other measurements. I'm gonna go ahead and jump on that. I'll bring you guys back, show you what the specs that I had, and we'll go from there. Okay, to measure the depth of this impeller, I'm just gonna use some aluminum angle and set it here on the back face of the impeller and use some vernier calipers. Now, I don't wanna go ahead and measure it right here like so with this back edge of the caliper, although very easy and convenient, because if I were to measure it this way, it's also measuring the thickness of this metal. I could measure the metal, pull this measurement, do the math, but I also could just go ahead and measure it with this other back part of the caliper. A little bit more awkward to do it this way. You want to make sure you're holding the metal flat, but this is just my preferred method. Honestly, you can measure this either method you like, whatever is best for you, but essentially pull this measurement. You're going to want to pull it in a few areas, make sure it's consistent, which I've already done so, and I am. I'm a little bit, pretty much 3.3 inches. It varied from 3.296 to 3.3. So pull it, rotate the shaft, be sure you're consistent, get it in multiple areas. The next step is to get everything removed and pull one more measurement. Now, before I pop this impeller off, if you look real carefully, you can see the wear ring in there and you can see the equivalent gap on the back side where there's the machined surface for the impeller to the wear ring and then where the impeller starts to bulge out and get larger. So you can see that everything's machined for it to be up tighter, and that's what we're back here correcting. I just wanted to show this to you real quick before we popped everything apart. So let's get this impeller out and continue on. We went ahead and pulled our measurements with the depth of the impeller to the suction housing with the original shaft. We have the measurements with the new shaft with the inducer, and now is what I'm going to get is the measurements with the impeller, the suction housing with no shaft, and that's going to go ahead and tell me the absolute furthest forward that this can sit. Now while it's out, we have a good look here, and if you look into the suction housing, you can see this lip right here. That's the forward lip where we want our clearance. Now since this pump, like I mentioned, was previously rebuilt and set up, this wear ring has been machined to the impeller, and this back lip of the wear ring has been machined to the back face of the impeller also. So I don't need to worry about setting up all the clearances. I'm just trying to return this impeller where it used to be. So by setting the impeller in here, it's going to go ahead and allow it to bottom out on both of these registers. But for now, I'm going to go ahead and set it in here, get that raw measurement, and then we'll go to the notepad and compare with everything we had. So I've already pulled the measurements. You can see that I set the impeller all the way in. That gap that I previously mentioned and showed you guys is gone on the back side. There's no gap on the front side. And we used our same angle, same method to measure it, and pulled measurements. Now I did it in multiple locations and also multiple orientations of the impeller to be sure I have a good average. We'll jump to our notepad. So on this notepad here, you can see that I have all my dimensions that I pulled. This far column on the right is my averages. So this first number, which is 3 inches, 129 thousandths, that's my original impeller with the original shaft. So that's the desired depth that we're looking for to put it back to where it was. The impeller with the new shaft is now sitting at 3 inches, 298 thousandths. And then the impeller with no shaft at all is three inches and 88 thousandths. Now, like I mentioned, we're desired clearance, 25 to 40 thousandths. If I add that desired clearance to my impeller with no shaft, it should add up to the original height, which it's pretty close at a 40 thousandths clearance. So to determine how much I need to take off my new shaft, I took my total depth of the impeller on the new shaft, which is 3 inches, 298 thousandths, and I subtracted the impeller with no shaft at all. So we subtracted the 3 inches, 88 thousandths, and that gave me a difference of 210 thousandths. So from that 210, we subtracted our desired gap or clearance that we're gonna set on our impeller, which I went with 41 thousandths here. And you can see that this is telling us we need the machine 169 thousandths off the shaft. I'll probably make it a nice round number, 170 thousandths, and go from there. As I mentioned, I do have these shims and they go in 5, 10, 20, I think 30 and 40 thousandths is the different sizes I have. So I have a little bit of flexibility if I machine too much. So if we look here on the shaft, you can see that I have two registers. Now, before I pulled the shaft out of the pump, I did pull the impeller off this back register. I pulled the inducer and spacer off the front. I did put the impeller back on. I knew that these two in relation to each other were machined appropriately. I just wanted to be sure that the impeller still had too much clearance back here without the inducer, and that is correct. So I'm going to machine equal amounts off of this register here and this register back here, which is going to shift everything forward. Now, if I went and was to install the impeller without the inducer and everything was fine, then my problem is in relation to these two and this register in relation to this back one. That's not my problem. So again, I'm going to machine up here and that's going to slide the impeller forward. Machine up here, that's going to slide the inducer forward. Now I have this set to roughly 170 thousandths and you can see that it's close, but I'll be able to get this machined and not get into the keyways. Also, both keyways are shorter than the total grooves, so I don't have to worry about changing anything on the keyway grooves. I can just go ahead and get this on a lathe, get these two turned down, and we should be set. Off to the machine shop I go. I'll be back here in a second. We'll pick this video back up, and I'll tell you what results we came with on the shaft and the impeller fitment. We'll continue on with the stuffer, and at the end, we'll go a little bit deeper in impeller clearances. All right, so I was able to get both the shaft and the bowl machined at the machine shop, and I have them set right where I need them. Got them on the first shot. But before we go in and start talking about the clearances, there is one thing I want to show you on the shaft and how it was machined that's worth talking about. So here's our shaft post-machining, and is what I wanted to talk about is what it looks like after they machined it. Now you can see where there is essentially a low area and then this ridge that's at the same diameter here as the shaft and another low area. Now this is intentional. This first undercut right here was where the shaft originally was, and then they cut it back and put that undercut back into it. And that undercut is what I wanted to show you guys, or at least talk about. So let me go to the whiteboard and I'll go in a little bit more detail. So I have just a quick mock-up of a simple shaft here with one register on it with no undercut. Now the reason why the undercuts are on that shaft that I have there, it's to avoid this 90 degree corner. If you were to turn this down on a lathe and have this sharp 90 degree corner, that actually right in there is a weak point. It can cause a stress fracture and you can actually have the shaft break. So when you're machining something on this register, if we were to have one right here, you would want to have it come up and actually have a radius to it. And that way it's a nice soft transition. It's much stronger. The problem with that lies when you go to slide the impeller and the inducer on, they don't have a matching radius on the inside. So as they would slide on, it's going to catch right here and you're not going to be able to seat all the way in. So if this was the inducer right here, it's not going to be able to seat because that radius is stopping it. And it's also going to drive that into that corner, which again is not good. So in order to compensate for that, the way they machine these shafts is they have the shaft come down and then you put an undercut in it and then it brings it back to your normal diameter. So that way the main plane of the shaft, whatever you go and slide on, is going to be able to slide on and sit flush on this register here and not get caught on that radius if you had the radius in the same plane. That's why when my shaft was machined further back and they put the new radius back in, that's why you can see that extra radius on the front. Again, that's ultimately not going to go ahead and compromise strength because it's a nice smooth gradual radius, and that is the best way to have this machined so that way I don't have any issues down the road. Okay, so with that radius covered, let's take one more peek at the shaft here and we'll be able to get hopefully a good understanding of what's going on. So you can see up here where the original radius was, the shaft was machined here and stopped. And this is where they machined the shaft further forward to give me my clearances at the same diameter they had here, hence why it exposed that radius all the way, and they machined it further forward. Then if you look real carefully, you can see that they went and undercut it to give me that radius, and that's going to go ahead and allow my inducer to slide all the way forward and not get hung up on that radius and to sit flat on this surface right here, and that's important for all my clearances. So yep, it looks a little goofy, but that's the way it should be. You know, ideally the shaft would have been machined correctly or to the right dimension the first time, but in the end this is the way we corrected it. I need to get the shaft back into the suction housing, and then we need to go ahead and grab our inducer and impeller, confirm that we have the clearances we need, and then let's go ahead and address this bowl and stuffer. Okay, shaft's been machined, got everything reassembled once again. I did go through and torque this nut because there was a little bit of compression and I wanted to be sure that my stack up and assembly is correct. I went ahead and measured it the same way, set this bar across it, measured in between the back face of the impeller and the front face of the suction housing, and measured that clearance. Now, after the machining, my impeller is sitting 3 inches and 111 thousandths from the back face of the suction housing. You remember the target that I was aiming for with my original shaft was 3 inches, 112 thousandths. So I'm now sitting 10 thousandths further forward towards the suction housing than I was before. That's because I changed what I did on you guys in between filming the videos. After doing the initial calculations, I determined that I needed to pull 170 thousandths off of the shaft, which was correct. But I didn't want to have the shaft machined and then have it be too shallow, so I actually requested the machine shop take 180 thousandths off of the shaft, and that was going to give me room to use those shims I have to bring the impeller to the spec that I wanted. Well, pretty much nailed it on that one because I have no shims right now. I thought I needed 170 pulled off. My impeller is sitting 10 thousandths too low, and I had to machine the shaft 10 thousandths further than I thought I needed. So that means I'll go ahead and stuff in a 10,000 shim. That's going to go ahead and bring this impeller back up, and we're going to be back to where we started with before I did any work. I need to break this apart, put the shim in, confirm those measurements, and I'll bring you guys right back. All right, 10,000 shim is in. Essentially, I have this impeller back to where it was spec'd at with the old shaft before I installed the inducer, when this pump was essentially set up previously in its life. So everything thus far that I've talked about is only the axial clearance of the impeller, meaning the depth of the impeller sitting in the housing. Now we use all those measurements when we set the impeller in with no inducer or shaft, and then with the shaft, and we can calculate what our clearance should be. But I'm going to get this suction housing up on the bench and I'm going to show you how you can go in there and actually measure it with some feeler gauges to confirm that your math all works out correct, and just a way to cross check yourself. All right, I got the suction housing up on the bench so we can measure the clearance. I do come in from the intake and you have to take some small feeler gauges. You can work them around the inducer and you can measure your clearance. Now you should really have the bowl on to help support the back of the shaft to make sure you have a good, accurate measurement. I have that off because we need to talk about the stuffer here in a second, but I have measured it with it on and I'm sitting at about 38 thousandths right now. Back on the sheets, looking at those numbers before with the original shaft, it was at about 32 thousandths. So now we have essentially the impeller back originally where it could be. Now I could jump back to the 5 thousandth shim and remeasure everything and see if that gets me closer to the original dimensions. But for now, I'm just gonna go ahead and leave it. So we need to talk about the stuffer and see what I did there and how to get those measurements so we can finish up this pump. Okay, let's talk about this stuffer. So this stuffer, where it interfaces or where it sits in the bowl to the impeller, you need to measure that. This one's 115 thousandths thick. So you can see here, if I insert it in, it's that surface right there. So that thickness matters. There's a couple different ways you can measure this clearance. You can put some clay or Play-Doh back here and then go ahead and bolt the bowl back on. And then you can cut that clay and measure how much clearance you have after it squishes it and deforms it. You can use the same method that I use. You can run a bar across, measure the height of the impeller to the suction housing, and then you can place that bar on the back side of the bowl and run it down to this surface right here, which is where the stuffer sits on. And you can do the math to determine how much clearance you actually have back there. Now, on a lot of these pumps that aren't modified, you might even have enough clearance where you don't have to do any machining to get this stuffer in. On mine, there was no chance. So with all the work that we did getting the impeller back to where it originally was, I kind of cheated a little bit on this because this pump was set up with such small clearances on the front and back side of the impeller. I basically knew that nothing was changing once I got the impeller back to its original shape. I'm adding something that's 115 thousandths thick. Therefore, I needed to have 115 thousandths milled off this register here inside the bowl. So I cheated. I didn't really spend a ton of time measuring. I just took the bowl to the machine shop, had them cut out 115 thousandths and put the stuffer in and got it on the first shot. So I was only able to do so because I knew that this was set up previously. If this was a fresh build, you're going to need to spend more time measuring, setting those clearances so you know how much to be machined, if any at all. Now, just like the front, I was aiming for 30, 35 thousandths of clearance from the back of the impeller to the face here of the stuffer. And I can verify that off of the math like we mentioned. But another thing you can do is you can install your shaft, leave your bolt off, install the stuffer into the bowl, install the bowl with the gasket, and then you can actually measure, if you know your front clearance, like I said, I'm at 38 thousandths. I can push everything rearward to where the impeller is going to contact the stuffer, remeasure the clearance in between the front of the impeller to the suction housing, and then I can take that clearance, subtract the original 38 thousandths, and that will tell me the rear clearance. So there's multiple ways you can measure this clearance. I like to run through and kind of hit each method to verify them upon each other method to be sure that my numbers are consistent, and it just kind of gives me a good way to self-check to make sure that is the clearance I do indeed have. All right, so I have the bowl width and stuffer installed on the pump. I have the 10,000 spacer installed on the impeller. Everything's set up and assembled. The rope seals are out of this, but you can go and see that I can easily rotate the shaft. Everything moves free and clear. We're set and we're good. Now let's take a minute. Like I promised in the video, we're gonna talk about these clearances a little bit. Now everything we did in this video, we only talked about the axial clearance, specifically the space of or gap of the impeller to the suction housing and the backside of the impeller to the bowl. I didn't do anything with radial clearance with the wear ring because, as I mentioned, this pump was rebuilt, that wear ring was put in, it's never been ran with it. That clearance is already set, I didn't need to deal with it. But in general, if we're gonna talk about radial clearance, that can change a little bit varying on what kind of impeller you wanna run. You can run a tighter clearance if you're running a stainless steel impeller versus an aluminum impeller because of the growth of the metal is less on the stainless steel. On this one, it's set up for about 25 thousandths, which would be about 12 and a half thousandths on each side of the impeller to the wear ring on the shoulder of that impeller where it sits. Now, since this pump has been modified in the past and they tightened everything up, they had moved that forward lip of that impeller forward in the suction housing, bringing that clearance down to, I mean, I can set it as low as 25 thousandths right now if I wanted to, but I have it shimmed back a little bit. And again, we're aiming for the 35 to 40 thousandths range. Same thing on the back of the bowl. They machined things down previously that brought those clearances tight. I had to re-machine some more to accommodate the thickness of the stuffer. Now, the reason why you want those tight clearances is you don't want any water getting past the impeller, or you don't want that water getting past the impeller and causing cavitation or aeration. All of those things reduce the efficiency of the pump, and it can, you know, cavitation can actually chew up your impeller and cause quite a bit of damage, but it just makes the pump more efficient. I would have not gone through and chased all this, but I kind of got myself in a wormhole by installing this inducer and then the shaft swap on me, and this whole thing snowballed. And at a certain point, I was just trying to make sure it's back to where it was. I just had to fix the situation I had. Looking back on it, I probably would have been better off just leaving this as is, but my boat is pretty big. It's 20 and a half feet. It's pretty heavy. It's a family cruiser, so I felt that adding the inducer is really worth it on this bigger, heavier boat. So really, that's how I got myself in this mess. But now everything's set back up. The pump is good to go. Gonna do a little bit more work on this pump, getting it dressed up and cleaned back up before it goes in the boat. But if you guys are looking to install a stuffer or an inducer on your boat, or even set clearances, hopefully this video showed you the things that you can do, watch out for, how to measure, and just gave you a better understanding of what's going on. Now, with what was done to this pump previously before I ever got it, where all these clearances got brought closer to each other, specifically the radial clearance, that's what you're gonna refer to as a tight pump or a race pump, where they're just trying to bring everything closer together to maximize efficiency. Now you're gonna wonder, why does not every pump come that way? A, it's difficult to manufacture and cast these with those tight of tolerances without all the custom measuring and machining. And also, depends how you use your boat. Since this pump's so tight, I'm gonna be really prone to, if I pick up sand or rocks, it's gonna cause some problems if they get in there in between that wear ring and that impeller. And it's not as forgiving if you have a looser pump. So more performance, less forgiving. For me, I have two pumps for this boat. I have the Dominator with an aluminum impeller, and I have this Berkeley with this stainless impeller. I can't swap the impeller. It's made for this pump. I'll take the downside of this tighter pump, even though I don't need it because it's not a race boat, for that stainless impeller. So that's just the decision I made. For me, the trade-off is worth it. If you guys like the video, go ahead and hit the like button, share it with a buddy. Appreciate you guys for taking the time to watch the video. Appreciate the support. We'll see you guys in the next video. Thanks for watching.